welcome. To Fight Factory Pro Wrestling episode 28. In our main event, we have Irish tag team titles on the line as the Savers of Destiny defend their tag team titles against none other than Boisterous Behavior. But we open with a number one contenders match for those titles. The winner of this triple threat tag team match, they will face the winner of the Saviors versus Boisterous Behavior on our next show, episode 29. But who's it going to be? Could it be the team of Gallicini and AJ Scraggs? Could it be the Bearded Beauties? Or could it be this team right here? Team that only recently formed. They're actually coming in off a loss, which many seen as a surprise loss. But before we get to that, Gallicini is trying to get AJ Scraggs on his side. Well, they put a poll on Twitter to decide what their theme song should be for tonight. Justin Bieber's greatest tracks were all up for grabs. The people have spoken, and we are getting Baby. Beautiful, it really is. One of the best entrances you will see in Irish professional wrestling today. I mean, you know it's good when your opponents are your enemies in the ring, or you're fighting tooth and nail to beat for a shot at the big one, are dancing to your entrance. That's when you know you've made the right decision. LJ and Fabio, as I was saying, as cool as this entrance is, they're coming in off a loss against the Bearded Beauties, so it's going to be interesting to see how they bounce back off that. Many people expected them to come out with that with the win, but the Bearded Beauties showed that tag team experience counts, and in this match they have that in abundance. In all honesty, it almost feels like we're about to watch a 12-man tag team match, and that this is the first team to have entered, all six of these men. You really wouldn't think there's a lot on the line here. But this is Fight Factory, you never know what you're going to get. I do notice AJ Scraggs in the back. He's not quite feeling it. Everybody in this match seems to be feeling it, but AJ Scraggs, he's like the 12-year-old emo that you had in your class that was too cool for Justin Bieber. You know, they just discovered Metallica and things like that. I'm not saying I was that person. I'm just saying that appears to be who AJ Scraggs is right now. hard not to get emotional after a performance like that, but it is time to get down to business. And it is very serious business, despite what you might think. AJ Scribes may be the only man so far that's actually on the right, operating on the right wavelength. I mean, he knows what's at stake here. It's his career. I'm not gonna lie, I want. As much as I respect AJ Scraggs for taking this seriously, you know, sometimes it's good to just loosen up a bit, you know what I mean? Get into the same zone mentally as your tag partner, but. Getting underway with AJ Scraggs or Gallicini. They start in the arguably advantageous position of being on the apron as the bell rings. You know, it gives them time to sort of take it easy while their opponents get busy and wear themselves out. And already we're seeing some of the technical showcase from Butch, a very, very underrated wrestler. We actually saw a tweet just a few days ago from Owen Richards, one half of the Savers of Destiny, calling Butch Armstrong underrated. I mean, you're getting those sorts of tweets from you know, if you know the Savers of Destiny hate everyone. So for someone like that to be sending out a tweet about Butch Armstrong, you know, that means a lot. I mean, sometimes it's a line. I mean, if AJ Scraggs left, this would obviously benefit LJ and Butch. So, I mean, this is some solid mind games on their part, but I don't even think it's mind games. They just don't like the man. Nobody in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling really likes AJ Scraggs. That's just the situation we're in, unfortunately. I mean, I don't really like him, but he's a good wrestler, in fairness to him. Now, LJ Cleary going straight for the leg of Butch Armstrong. But as I was saying, Butch is a... technical wrestling credentials are often overlooked. His technical abilities, and this is interesting. You're here in the crowd, they're rooting for AJ. You know, his colleagues might not like him very much, but the fans, they appear to be warming to him, so. Strong wrestler, we've seen that. That's why he's really a great partner for JDP. Their styles complement each other, as unorthodox as they may be at times. A lot of very legitimate strength and power there. And LJ Cleary sending Butch off his feet. Butch Armstrong with an uppercut and a chop, sending LJ off his feet. And it'll be interesting to see whether or not he'll tag in JDP. He does. And now JDP's in. That's bad news for LJ Cleary. He is right where he doesn't want to be. As Butch is sent flying into him by his own partner. again for good measure, but this time it's JDP putting his full weight on LJ Cleary. And LJ tagging in Fabio, but AJ Scraggs is in there. Now Fabio, not the wisest strategy to go after the bearded beauties like that. One against two. I'll let that scream speak for itself. What's Gallicini going for here? Gallicini, if there's one thing you can... And there's one thing you can't deny about Gallicini is that he is the most impressive wrestler in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling. The most technically proficient? Possibly not. The strongest fight IQ? Possibly not. The strongest? Possibly not. But he is impressive. He does manage to find a way. And that is what the best do. Great agility on display from Fabio. That's what he does best. And Fabio on AJ Scraggs. Scraggs, I mean, this is what Scraggs is good at. He has an ugly fighting style. It's a gritty, ugly, dirty fighting style. And people, the fans don't like it. The fans aren't super into it. It's not flashy. It's not as, I mean, it's practically the polar opposite of his partner, Gallicini. But it is effective. You look at AJ Scraggs and where he is. I mean, a year ago, this man wasn't even wrestling on shows. And here he is in a number one contenders match for the tag team titles, alongside a partner with even less experience than he has. But that's because, you know, personality aside, he has the ability. A very strong pinky promise there between Gallicini and Scraggs. Now Gallicini's in there. He wants AJ Scraggs to put on his jewellery. And, you know, I mean, look, Gallicini has a point. You look at the best tag teams in history. They all had matching gear. They all had a matching team song. They all have, you know, a tag team name. These are things that AJ Scraggs and Gallicini are going to have to work on if they want to be the best. Butch Armstrong now. Fists into the body of Fabio, and now JDP. JDP coming in and joining in on the attack. Butch Armstrong is tied in. And the bearded beauties are working well together, and this is what I was talking about, that tag team experience. You know, you look at the experience of Butch and JDP, you know, working together. It's something that Fabio and LJ don't have. It's something that Gallicini and Scraggs certainly don't have. And it's something that could potentially get them to win here. Gallicini's, oh, he's looking to get tagged in. And Butch not opting for it. It would have been interesting to see, but Gallicini seems hell-bent on being tagged in as part of the Bearded Beauties. Maybe he's had enough. Maybe he's just not into AJ Scraggs as a partner. Maybe he's given up. Or maybe this is part of Gallicini's plan. You know, maybe I said that he didn't have the strongest fight IQ in Fight Factory, but you know what? You look at Gallicini, and there kind of is a strong mental game there. He's quite unpredictable. He's quite different. Quite different. He's very different. And see, it was part of the plan. In he comes. Throws away the Bearded Beauties t-shirt. He's calling it mind games. You know, look, it's a good idea in theory, but in practice, needs a bit of work. Gallicini drops Fabio. Fabio lands on his feet. Get him, Fabio! Oh, and Gallicini. One of Gallicini's greatest strengths as a fighter really is avoiding taking damage, more so than dishing it out. It's his slickness in the ring that makes him such an interesting phenomenon to watch. So when you see him getting hit in the way that he is now from Fabio, it does make you worry for his chances in this match. He's not necessarily known for his durability, but rather his quickness, his ability to think on his feet. Fabio tags in LJ. Butch gets tagged in on the other side, and LJ gets the upper hand. He has all the momentum behind him. A super kick to JDP. And for the first time in this match, it looks like one team has the upper hand strong enough. Well, you know, commentator's curse. I was going to say, LJ Cleary looked like winning it, but JDP instead getting taken off his feet by the smaller man, and Butch comes in. And you have to think about how bad the Bearded Beauties want this as well. I mean, this is a team that, despite showcasing their ability week in and week out, this is a team who's struggled, you know, to win the big one in the past. They've had opportunities, they haven't quite made it, despite being as close as you can get to winning the big one. They just haven't been able to get the job done, and that's something that, you know, they realize that, they're aware of that, and it's something that drives them through each of their matches. It's why they're able to get wins over teams like Fabio and LJ in 2-on-2 competition. But of course, this is a very different type of game. We're dealing with a tag team division that's growing rapidly, and we're seeing, you know, three teams in there all at once. And JDP reversing Fabio, and Fabio landing on his feet. And Fabio using his quickness. I mean, this is why he's the greatest Irish junior heavyweight champion of all time. Those kicks, the agility, the athleticism. It's really something that really nobody else in this roster has to the level that he has. And that's something that he's using really to his advantage. But Butch Armstrong is now on his feet. And Butch with a sit-out spine buster. And Fabio rolls away. A flying knee from LJ Cleary. We've seen that in virtually all his matches. I mean, this is something that is such an important weapon for LJ Cleary. But Butch, now he's going off the middle rope, and LJ catches him. JDP takes the legs right out from underneath LJ Cleary. And in JDP's eyes, he sees the end. But this is not 2-on-2, and Gallicini comes back in. Gallicini on JDP, and he gets it. A tornado DDT incapacitates JDP for the time being. Very impressive from Gallicini. I mean, this is only his third fight here in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling on our episodes. And AJ Scraggs. Ah, oh, he tried, to be fair. AJ Scraggs with a drop kick to LJ, and Fabio knocks Butch out of the ring, and now he's got JDP to deal with. AJ Scraggs using everything he can, try and get the better of JDP. JDP gets his head rammed into the canvas. Gallicini tagged himself in. JDP didn't see it, and Gallicini, this could be it. Sometimes the adrenaline just takes over. A Sometimes, look, sometimes it just takes over. I mean, they got a one count. It was a great one count, but it was just a one count nonetheless. They did not win the match despite what they think. And Fabio coming in from behind. And he steals it for LJ and Fabio. Yeah, I mean, it would have been nice to see Gallicini and AJ Scraggs get that opportunity, but if you're celebrating a one count, how are you meant to stand toe-to-toe with the Sabres or with the boisterous behaviour? And, you know, how are you meant to compete, basically? I don't know. There's a long way to go for both of those men. The Bearded Beauties, they're devastated. They got the job done against LJ and Fabio on episode 27. They're going to feel a bit hard done by. But ultimately, these are the opportunities you need to be able to take advantage of if you want to be champions. And LJ and Fabio, I mean, that's what they do best. A lot of mutual respect here. Amongst all of these men, but... mutual respect is one thing, but they are not going to be happy with that. However, episode 29, we have some exciting tag team action to look forward to. Regardless of who wins, regardless of whether it's Saviors, regardless of whether it's Slater and DeReese, it's going to be a good one. But AJ Scribes, you know, is he starting to get, I won't say liked by his colleagues, but he's starting to get the respect of his colleagues. Because very quickly we're starting to see that AJ Scraggs has a lot of passion, he has a lot of heart, and a lot of ability as well. I mean, I don't really think angering JDP is the wisest move, but oh, whoa, what is this? This is a bit unnecessary. I don't think we've seen this from the Bearded Beauties before. This is, oh, what the. And now LJ and Fabio have to come out there to calm things down. I mean, this is what I'm talking about. The Bearded Beauties, when you get so close to winning championships and you lose, you know, more than once, it starts to get to you. You beat LJ and Fabio in tag team competition and then lose the following show. It's... well, I'm glad to see cooler heads have prevailed. That is not like Butch or JDP. That is not their style. But, and this is a fight that I am very excited for. Very, very excited for. JB is somebody who, up until his tag team with Party Boy, had an incredibly bad win-loss record. He showed a lot of potential physically, but mentally his head was in a completely different place. His fuse was so short, he was egotistical, and yeah, he's still a little bit egotistical, but after the success that he's achieved as part of a tag team with Party Boy, it's almost like a completely different man. Terry Thatcher, this is somebody who Fight Factory management have already said on Twitter we are going to be seeing a lot more of on future shows, and that is brilliant news. This is somebody who I've wanted to see. I mean, every time Terry Thatcher has a match scheduled in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling, I'm excited, because it always delivers. It's always an absolute banger. Now, it has to be said, he doesn't always win in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling. Results are kind of 50-50 with Terry Thatcher so far here in Fight Factory. But they're guaranteed bangers. So for the fans, it's a win-win no matter what. But for Terry Thatcher, you know, he's going to really want to focus on this match to play to his strengths to stop JB from taking advantage. He went in against Martin Steers, our current champion, at episode 27 and took Steers to his limit. So I'd expect Terry Thatcher to turn those results around sooner rather than later. But, you know, we've seen what happens if one loss leads to another, you can end up on a skid, similar to what happened to JB earlier on in his career up until a few months ago. But the difference in this case is Terry Thatcher has experience. Terry Thatcher, when it comes to Irish wrestling, Terry Thatcher has been there, done that. But this is an interesting point, because as I've said, JB is a completely different man to what he used to be. He has effectively addressed his weaknesses by becoming a completely different person from, you know, a confidence standpoint, from a personality standpoint. To have somebody in his corner like Party Boy, who he now respects, and dare I even say admires a little bit, he has that support network now. Somebody who can kind of keep him in check for big matches such as this against Terry Thatcher. And you know, it's been a while since we've seen JB in singles competition generally. He used to treat his tag matches like singles matches, but they weren't. And for me, I look at a wrestler like CBL, who we're going to be seeing next, competing for the Irish Junior Heavyweight Championship. I see where he was a year ago, and I look at the roster and I think, who's next? Who's going to be the next wrestler to make that big step up to the top tier? I'm looking at the likes of Big Rab, who we'll also see later. I think he's got a chance of becoming the next big thing, the next, you know, to follow in the footsteps of someone like CBL. But I also look at JB. You know, I look at JB and I see just how he carries himself now in the ring. It's completely different to the JB we've seen before, and people are cheering for Terry Thatcher, but JB. And it's unusual, but it also feels kind of right. And I wouldn't be surprised if JB, I mean, at the end of the day, he was meant to be in that main event on our last show, and he couldn't make it because he was injured. That's the level that JB could potentially be operating at now, but this is the exact test that he needs to prove that he belongs in that conversation. Because Terry Thatcher, I mean, beating Terry Thatcher, that pretty much proves that you are the man. You are here. You are, you know, a main event level talent. Otherwise, you know, it's very difficult to make that argument to get into Irish Junior Heavyweight Championship contention. If not, but of course, it is a tough task. So it's going to be very, very interesting. So far, Terry Thatcher, currently with wrist control on JB, but what's interesting for me here is JB is the bigger man, JB is arguably the stronger man, but Terry Thatcher is somebody who's known for his durability, which is precisely something that JB wouldn't be known for. So it's just the way this balances out is very, very interesting. On paper, you'd imagine that Terry Thatcher is probably the favourite, but you know, again, it's tough because we haven't seen much of JB in singles action since his recent transformation, so we're going to have to wait and see. So far, Terry Thatcher doing what Terry Thatcher does best. And a neck breaker. It's not enough, but the more JB finds himself on the end of these things, the more he has to kick out. Yeah, the more it's going to test him mentally. That is the real test for JB, the mental side of things. Terry Thatcher! Just pulling down on the neck of JB. Wear them out. It's very interesting to see, you know, the crowd split down the middle. Of course, a lot of people see what JB has become and they do like him. But Terry Thatcher's, again, arguably the most respected wrestler on the island. You know, Terry Thatcher is somebody who's held titles in the past, somebody who's been through wars in the past. But what JB's going to want to try and take advantage of if he can is exactly that. I'm back with Terry Thatcher, somebody who's been around since I was starting school, effectively. Somebody who's been around, like, for almost 2 decades. I mean, this is somebody who's been through a lot physically, so if you can wear down that body and, you know, punish Terry Thatcher physically, that would probably be the key to success, because agility-wise, you look at Terry Thatcher's speed and his quickness, and, you know, it's very difficult to beat him at his own game. You're going to have to really try and wear him out. But JB is clutching onto his arm. He doesn't look to be in the greatest spot physically himself. So far, Terry Thatcher's had the upper hand for most of this. Terry Thatcher is dictating the pace, effectively, as he stomps JB into the corner. Terry Thatcher. Oh, slipping off the middle rope. That's never what you want. And as the night goes on, that's something that's always more likely to happen. You know, as more people use the ring. But Terry Thatcher always finds a way to adapt. He's the sort of person where if things don't go his way, he'll find another way to make it work. And that's why he's in the position that he's in all these years later, still here. Plenty of wrestlers over the course of Terry Thatcher's career, plenty of wrestlers, and I mean plenty, have come and gone, but he is still here because he can still cut it at this level. And I can't understate how impressive that is. What's very interesting with Terry Thatcher as well is when he goes up to the top turnbuckle. Now, unfortunately, he took a bit too long there, and JB is able to take advantage of his precarious position. But Terry Thatcher, usually the distance that he can leap from the top turnbuckle is very, very impressive. But it's not going to be much use to him now because JB came up to fight him. But now it will, because JB finds himself on the other side of the ring. But he recovers and just launches Terry Thatcher across the ring. And a rough landing for Thatcher. But an impressive display of athleticism from JB. We don't normally associate it with athleticism the same way you would with the likes of Thatcher, the likes of, you know, Fabio Stiers. He's kind of got a different style of his own. But this is what I'm talking about. I mean, JB, he's slowly improving. Oh, I say slowly, he's quickly improving all areas of his game. And even though he might not be the favorite in this fight, I don't think anyone would rule him out. And JB and Terry Thatcher exchanging chops. And now kicks to the arm of Terry Thatcher. This is very smart from JB to target the arm with those kicks. It's got good precision, good power behind those kicks. And hits Terry Thatcher with yet another kick. And a German suplex is not enough to put Terry Thatcher away. Sometimes that can work. You get good momentum behind your pin when you pin somebody in that fashion, but it wasn't enough for JB in this case. But look into the eyes of JB. Again, how often do you see this in a JB singles match? Confidence. That's what we're seeing. We're seeing confidence. We're seeing somebody look like they're about to win the match, and Terry Thatcher lands on his feet, and Inseguri sends JB into the position that he doesn't want to be in, on the middle rope. And off the middle rope, a moonsault. JB kicks out a two. Thatcher, that's what I was talking about. The distance that he can make across the ring. I mean, he was in the wrong corner, effectively. It's not enough to put JB away, but he's in the wrong corner. Most wrestlers would look at that and go, ah, I need to do the walk across the ring. But Terry Thatcher, he just goes for it, and he gets it every single time. That flying elbow straight to the center of JB's chest, but it's not enough to put him away. And that means only one thing. The straps go up. The straps come down. It's the detachment. No, it's countered by JB. You hit him with a flying knee. And this is brilliant from JB. We've seen this scissor kick so many times. He misses. Terry Thatcher rolls him up. And oh! Terry Thatcher pushed in the party boy there. Now he's going for the detachment, but it's countered again. I thought JB had it there for a second. A lovely suplex from JB. A falcon arrow. And Terry Thatcher kicks out a two. And it makes you wonder, you know, had Terry Thatcher not shouted, as he always does, the signature brace yourself, is there a chance that JB potentially would have wouldn't have hurt him? Potentially wouldn't have counted it for the second time. Very impressive from JB. Very good fight IQ to counter not one but two attempts at the detachment. But again, he goes for a second scissor kick. Terry Thatcher counters that. And now Party Boy's up on the ring apron. And JB gets sent in the Party Boy. And a super kick from Terry Thatcher. Third attempt at detachment. Gets it this time. JB still has a long way to go to achieve singles victory in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling. I did say that JB could potentially, 1 year from now, be in that main event, you know, in that main event circle, somebody challenging for Irish Junior Heavyweight gold, but he ended up getting launched into Party Boy. Things didn't quite work out. But I mean, there's still a lot of positives to take for this, to take from this for JB. I mean, you look at how he stood toe to toe with one of the best Irish wrestlers ever in Terry Thatcher, and he held his ground. He showed a whole different side to himself that we've never seen before. He has the respect of Terry Thatcher. He very nearly could have won this match. You know, a couple of tweaks here and there, a couple of things going the other way, a couple of slight moves here and there, and you know, this could have been a very different outcome for JB. So I wouldn't really beat myself up too much. If I was JB, I would take from this the positives. This is interesting, very interesting. Usually CBL comes out, he makes his entrance, goes through the crowd, he celebrates, he has a bit of a laugh, but this is a very serious CBL. This is a fired up CBL, and I've never seen CBL this serious. Even when LJ Cleary many months ago tried to get him to become serious, to become the wrestler that he is today, he did get serious, but this is on an emotional level. This is on a personal level. CBL, on our last show, was about to achieve the greatest accomplishment of his entire career thus far. He was about to achieve the ultimate goal, an Irish Junior Heavyweight Championship, long for his first ever wrestling champion. And it was taken from him after Martin Steers decided to insert himself into the main event and cash in. And if you're a CBL, I mean, you've come so close now. You know, he had a match against Leighton Buzzard, came up short, had the five-way, and looked like he was about to right the wrongs of his match against Leighton Buzzard. Only to get robbed, and now this is it. This is effectively last chance saloon for CBL. And here is the champion, the man who has terrorized Fight Factory Pro Wrestling for over a year now. This all started when he decided to turn his back on Klong, to turn his back on Club Rock Shandy, the most beloved tag team in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling, to pursue a singles career. And it was a gamble. You know, he was guaranteed success at Club Rock Shandy, but he decided to burn every bridge he possibly could for himself. If this didn't work out, he was on his own. But, I mean, to say that it worked out would be an understatement. He won the briefcase, he won the belt, and now he's the man here in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling.
Singles match scheduled for one fall. That was for the Irish Junior Heavyweight Championship. But if you see first, the challenger on my right. He's the only champion player. He's next to the mutiny. The Loafer Lad,
it hurts me to say it, but you have to give Martin Steers credit. One thing you can't deny about Martin Steers is the confidence. You see it in the entrance, you see it when he holds the belt above his head. It's almost as if he never had any doubt. He always knew he was going to be in this position one way or another. And fortunately for CBL, the way that he went was through him. Interesting, because we've seen Martin Steers the contender, but we've never seen Martin Steers the champion. We've seen him as a tag champion, we've never seen him as a singles champion. What any champion will tell you is that once you win the belt, that's all well and good winning the belt, but defending it is a whole different story, especially in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling. You have all these young, hungry challengers, people who are destined for huge things in their career. People like CBL coming at you literally the show after you win it. You don't even have time to process what's going on before you're defending it. don't expect Martin Steers to be overwhelmed by that. But it is still very interesting to see. For CBL, however, he has to deal with a whole set of pressure really of its own. You know, not only representing the county of Longford, but also the fact that, you know, as I've said, it's almost last chance saloon. I mean, if he doesn't win it now, in his third world title shot in 3 months, it kind of, you lose that and all of a sudden you start to question yourself a little bit. And, you know, we've seen it with JB, we've seen it, you know, with plenty of wrestlers in the past, what happens if you know, you lose one, you lose two, and all of a sudden you're on a streak, because it affects you mentally. And, you know, you can work on yourself physically as much as you want, but mentally, that's where it counts. And it's the hardest part of the body to work on. But physically speaking, this is quite an interesting matchup as well, because physically with CBL you're dealing with strength and power, and with Steers you're dealing with speed and agility. What separates Martin Steers from the pack is usually you'll see wrestlers like Martin Steers who have the speed, who have the agility, who have the movement, the athleticism, the quickness, but those are usually not the most ruthless of wrestlers. Usually the wrestlers who are the most ruthless are the biggest, the strongest, maybe the brawlers, the deathmatch wrestlers, whoever you want to point that. It's usually not the smaller, quicker wrestlers. They're usually more focused on winning the match. But with Martin Steers, not only is he focused on winning the match, but there's also a level of ruthlessness to Steers that you don't typically see with other wrestlers. And that's really what separates champions from contenders. We're yet to really see that ruthless side of CBL, and that's why he's been coming up short in matches as of late. Of course, he was, you know, quite unlucky in his last fight, to be fair. But so far, it's been evenly matched. We've seen both men kind of get the upper hand on each other, and CBL off the top. CBL not afraid to take risks. Steers sending CBL into the ropes, and there's Steers over the top. And, you know, really, if you're CBL, you're going to want to have, you know, contain Martin Steers. That's pretty much the objective of the CBL. Contain Martin Steers, control the pace, slow him down. The more room you give Martin Steers to operate, the more damage he is going to do. That's effectively what he has shown, you know, time and time again. He knows how to work his way around the ring. His fight IQ is excellent. He is, even against Terry Thatcher in our last show, his ability to find the ropes when he needs to and get the rope break, it's, you know, it's, Steers mentally is so, so strong, and that is key to him being in the position that he's in. It's very, very impressive. You know, we've just seen Fabio become the greatest Irish junior heavyweight champion of all time. Before that, it was LJ Cleary. You look at Martin Steers, and you know, you think on one hand, that's his destiny. Surely he's going to be the next Irish junior heavyweight champion that holds the title for, you know, a year or 2 years or whatever the case may be. But then you look at CBL and you realize, well, actually, the championship could change hands right now in a matter of minutes, or in a second. When he's hitting moves like that, taking people's heads off with lariats. But this is what I'm talking about. You need to contain Martin Steers, because he's so quick. He can make something out of nothing. He can create opportunities that don't exist. Steers. Well, neck breaker, and he's talking. But you know, some people, they'll say, you know, oh, a wrestler shouldn't be focusing on, you know, talking shit to the audience or the fans, should be focusing on their opponent, etc., etc. But you have to remember, everyone's different. Some wrestlers, they almost find it motivational. They almost find that it fuels them, and that it also helps them to keep focus, because, you know, it's one thing to lose a match, it's another to lose a match with the entire crowd rooting against you after you've just opened your mouth, and you know, it just works. It works for Martin Steers, as does that move right there. He's dishing out a lot of damage to the head of CBL, and that's quite an interesting strategy. Usually the smaller fighters, they'll target the legs, they'll target, you know, they'll target limbs to try and slow down their opponent, but Martin Steers, you know, he's not chopping down CBL like a tree. He's going straight for the head, he's going for the neck. And you know, if you can get that right first time, that can be serious for you know, for really wearing down your opponent. But CBL is far from worn down, and CBL, he's after catching a second win of sorts. And CBL with an exploder suplex and a missile dropkick. Martin Steers hit that turnbuckle. I mean, he hit those turnbuckle pads quite hard. And he looks at the wind taken right out from him. And that's what I'm saying. It can just take one bad landing and that belt is gone from the hands of Martin Steers without a single successful title defense. Trying to catch CBL. Oh, off the top, the tornado DDT. But Martin Steers, very quick pinfall attempts. That's something that Martin Steers has in his locker as well. You know, and we've seen him use that, as well as, of course, the springboard stunner. But and that's something that never works out either. We don't have VAR in wrestling. You know, Foxy's decision is final. Whether you feel like he's right or wrong is irrelevant. Not worry about that, but Foxy, for what it's worth, is almost always right. And that's what I'm talking about. Another quick pinfall attempt. You'll notice as well, he went for the springboard stunner there a minute ago and missed, which shows that CBL has things scouted as he goes for a quick pinfall attempt of his own. The crucifix position isn't enough to put CBL away. CBL, I mean, you just know he's done his homework. And he has studied and studied and studied before this match, because that is what the best do when they want to pull off the biggest victory of their career, because that's what this would be. And I don't want to say that it would be a huge upset if CBL was to beat Martin Steers, because everyone knows what CBL is capable of. But it would be a bit of an upset considering the streak that Martin Steers has been on. The shooting star press doesn't connect, and it's such a scary move to try in this venue with such a low ceiling, but Martin Steers doesn't care. And now CBL running the ropes, getting as much speed as he can, and a bicycle kick. Martin Steers looks to be rocked. If CBL can take full advantage of this, we could have a new champion. Immediately after we got ourselves a new champion last month, firmly behind CBL. I mean, that is something that will always help. Any wrestler will tell you that. You hear Martin Steers saying that this is his ring. And Martin Steers! I mean, what I was about to say was Martin Steers is not just talking shit for the sake of talking shit. He believes that. It's not something he just tells his opponent. It's something he tells himself. And it's something that he backs up with his actions. Those words have value. And you see it just like that. What I said earlier, creating opportunities out of absolutely nothing. Countering moves out of absolutely nothing. When people think that Martin Stairs is down and out, he always comes back. And it, you know, it's a shame that, you know, personality wise he is the way he is, because he's very difficult to like, but he's impossible to not respect. And CBL, this is CBL, this is what he does better than anyone else. You see Martin Stairs slapping CBL, but when you get into an exchange of strikes with CBL, I mean, really, that's CBL's to win, you know. Oh, and Martin Stairs pinning CBL. CBL kicks out a two. Again, Martin Stairs would have been going for that springboard stunner. CBL had it scouted for the second time. And Martin Stairs, again, always switched on, always using everything he can to escape situations. But it's not enough in this case. CBL goes up to the top turnbuckle. And Martin Stairs calling Foxy in between himself and CBL again. Martin Stairs always finds a way. That is why he has that big brown belt and not anybody else on this roster. Oh, and a low blow to CBL. And now Martin Stairs off the middle rope, springboard stunner. Very quickly goes for the pin and gets it done. Your winner and still. Your winner and still. I think that's a phrase we're going to be hearing for a long, long time here in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling, whether we like to admit it or not. Stairs has the ability. Martin Stairs is the real deal. There's every chance, when you talk about the greatest Irish Junior Heavyweight Champion of all time, there is every chance that Martin Stairs will be a part of that conversation in years to come. And I know that sounds dramatic. I know it's that's quite a heavy thing to say after just one title defense. But that's CBL. That's one of our best wrestlers at the minute. Somebody who's on the verge of achieving very big things. But, you know, Stairs was in there. He had the size disadvantage, the strength disadvantage. But he found a way. And it wasn't an honorable way. This is a team that I am very excited about. A team really that just popped up onto the scene there last month. Of course, they would have been in Next Gen, dominating Next Gen, because that's what you need to do to get on these episode shows. But it's a team really that I don't know a huge amount about. We really haven't seen a huge amount from them. But when you're brothers, you have that natural built-in chemistry. They've already got the support of the fans. They were kind of dealt a trial by fire at our last show against the Savior's Destiny. But to be fair, they stepped up, showed no fear, and they're being rewarded with another match here tonight against Team PB&J. Very interesting times for for Team PB&J. You know, Phil, this is the same Phil that won the tag team titles against Club Rock Shandy. The same Phil Boyd that went through wars against the likes of the Savers of Destiny. But this Justy, it's almost as if the Justy that we knew and loved for the last year is just, it's just not there anymore. That match against the Bear just, it has changed him. It's almost like the opposite of JB. We watched JB grow to a whole new level mentally, and we've seen him improve his game. Justy has regressed. Justy had that fight with the Bear, a fight that he's wanted his whole career, and once he came face to face with it, it changed him. And he's looking over his shoulder the whole time. I tried to talk to him earlier today before the show, and he just screamed and ran away. And you know, anybody who says the word Bear around him, they're thrown out of the room, or he storms out. He's not in a good way. Oh no. I mean that's you can't do that. I mean, yeah, Justy's not gonna be able to focus. He's not, I mean, with respect to the Bradley brothers, I mean, this in theory should be one of Team PB&J's easier matches, but you know, just because the experience and the big gap in experience, but if there's a Bear that's lingering around the Fight Factory, you know, Justy's done. This is a handicap match, effectively. Having the greatest of times, it has to be said. No, but if you're the Bradley brothers, I mean, this is a real opportunity. Yeah, and if there's one thing I know about the Bradley brothers, is that if they're taking on an opponent who isn't fully focused, they'll take advantage of that. Mutual respect being shown at the start, but Team PB&J, I mean, they don't have time for handshakes and, you know, small talk or anything like that. I mean, this is a team that needs to get back on track. They're not in the greatest state at the moment, and the Bradley brothers, they're actually off to a very impressive start. And the Bradley brothers again, already they've got that chemistry against, you know, to be taken on former Irish tag team champions, to be taken on two of the most experienced wrestlers on this island. Yeah, they're not off to a bad start, it has to be said. I'm impressed. Bill Boyd in there with, I believe, Bryce Bradley is the taller one. Eddie Bradley, the one in the corner at the minute. It'll be interesting to see exactly how Bryce shapes up against, you know, really the most technically proficient wrestler in the country. Oh, Bradley with a knee to Phil Boyd, and another knee to Justy. Tags in his brother, and oh, this is interesting. Off the shoulders of his brother, it's not enough to put away Justy, but yeah, this is good stuff. Going for pin attempts very, very early on. Not a bad thing. And these are really good cross bodies from Eddie Bradley. I was going to say wiping the boat out, but Phil, I mean, that's experience is what that is. That's Phil identifying what's coming next, putting measures in place to counter it before it has any time to develop. That's experience. It's fight IQ. And this is also fight IQ and tag team wrestling, getting your opponent right where you want them, in your own corner, so that he can be double teamed and as far away from his partner as possible. With that kick to the midsection. It's very interesting seeing this version of Team PB&J. This is a Team PB&J that, you know, they're a lot more ruthless than what we've seen in the past. They're known for being quite a fun team, quite a funny team to watch. But I mean, this is ultimately, above all else, they really don't want to come out here and lose with respect to this young, promising tag team. They don't want to come out here and lose to the Bradley brothers. That would be seen as a setback from their perspective. Although, to be fair, the Bradley brothers, you know, this is their second appearance on an episode, an episodic Fight Factory show, and yet, really, they look like they belong. I know, obviously, Team PB&J have dominated most of the match thus far, and that's to be expected, but they're not completely out of their depth. Sometimes you see wrestlers make their debut and you're like, yeah, not now. Now's not the time, you know, come back later. I wouldn't really be saying that about the Bradley brothers. You know, okay, I don't think they're gonna win this match, at least thus far it doesn't look like they're gonna, but you know, I wouldn't say that they don't belong. I think, you know, when you take a look at how young they are and their lack of experience, they have confidence, they have chemistry, they have the crowd behind them. They've been thrown to the wolves as well. You look at their wrestling CV, you know, against the Stables of Destiny. That, as I said, that's trial by fire. And they're coming in here against Team PB&J. I know there's no easy fights in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling, but I mean, had they started against, say, Galaxini and Scruggs, who are just sort of discovering themselves and finding themselves as a tag team, or even LJ and Fabio, who are you know, adjusting to their tenure as a tag team, will things be different? You know, you go in there against the Saviors have no questions to ask of themselves, you know, and we'll see that later on when they take on Darice and Slater. But Team PB&J would be in that same bracket as the Sabres. They've no... Well, of course, there is the issue with the Bear. But, I mean, as a tag team, we're talking about a team that are very much sure of themselves. They have no questions, no worries, no doubts. All the experience, all of the technical ability, all of the history, all of the accolades, the accomplishments. I mean, this is a team where, you know, you're going to... You're gonna struggle against Team PB&J, you know? And Justy, it's not just his words, he backs that up with his actions. I mean, a Justy that's concentrated without any bear distractions. I mean, that is, you know, that's a former former Phoenix champion, somebody who can get it all done on his own, but as part of this tag team with Bill, somebody who he's trained with since, yeah, since I was in junior infants probably. I mean, this is a very, very tough test for the Bradley brothers. And the tag is made. A lot of hard work being put in there by Eddie Bradley to make the tag, and he does, but Justy is now tagged in off the back of Phil. Bryce doesn't see it. And Bryce's momentum, well, I was gonna say it's come to a stop, but he's held his own in there. And a brilliant spine buster from Bryce Bradley. Now Eddie's come in off to the top turnbuckle. But Phil Boyd, again, it's that fight IQ, being able to push one of those Bradley brothers off the top turnbuckle the second he sees it. And a 3D. Well, I was going to say a 3D that finishes off this match. Not quite. Not quite. The Bradleys are still in this. I mean, certainly what about the Bradley brothers? Nobody can deny their heart thus far. They've really shown that they are made of what's required to make it in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling. Justin calling for the chair. Oh, off the apron. Bradley used himself as a weapon. And in the... Oh, God. Oh, my God. Oh my God. We all saw that. That was not just his imagination. We all saw that. Anyone who was on the stairs had run down, a bear had gotten in. Oh! And Bradley sending Justy into his partner, rolls up Justy, and it's a win for the Bradley brothers! And the Bradley brothers have gone 1-1 in their Fight Factory Pro Wrestling career thus far. They have a win over former Irish Junior Heavyweight Tag Team Champions. They have a win over Team PB&J. And you can talk about the assist from the bear all you want. Look, if you're Eddie and Bryce Bradley, all you need really is confidence. You know what I mean? Mentally, at this... the fact that they're in there, the fact they're standing toe-to-toe with Team PB&J at this stage of their career, that in itself is impressive. But to have gotten the result, I mean, these are going to be two very, very happy young wrestlers when they go into the back after this. I mean, this is your first win on a Fight Factory episode. Everyone remembers their first win. You know, this is a big, big deal. And they won't care about any assists. Come on. This is Gangland. This is Jay Steins, the ringleader. Unfortunately for Jay Steins, results haven't gone his way forever. But he's got a chance to break his not winning streak against Big Rob here tonight. It's going to be a tough test. But if anyone can break that streak, it is Jay Steins. Who's going to do a CBL on it? Who's going to go from, the lower end of the card to main event status in within the next year? The first person I think of is this man right here, Big Rob. The people were shouting for him before this match even started. And, as unpopular as Jay Steins is amongst this crowd, that's not the reason for Big Rob's positive reception. The reason Big Rob gets the reception that he does off these fans is because they have watched this man improve show after show, month after month, ever since he came back last year. He's just been... Honestly, Big Rob matches are some of my favourite matches to commentate because you can just see the adjustments, you can see the changes that he makes. Match after match, he's such a good learner. He's got such a good wrestling brain. It's not just, physical ability. It's crazy as well because we've seen him only a couple of years ago as a tag team wrestler alongside Justin Daniels. He was part of the 03. That genuinely feels like I'm talking about a different person altogether. I was going to say a different man, but he wasn't even a man back then. He was a kid. You look at Big Rob now, and the difference is that Big Rob is a man. You know what I mean? Big Rob could very well be the man here in Fight Factory in a very short time. And I'm expecting a very impressive display against Jay Steins here tonight. With all the respect, well, some respect to Jay Steins, I just look at Big Rob and I think he's on a whole different level. I'm gonna let the noise of those strikes speak for themselves. Right on the back of Jay Steins. You don't need to be some sort of technical wrestling expert to understand the effects. I mean, you can see the wear and tear on Jay Steins already. I mean, that's the size advantage and the power advantage on full display here for Big Rob. Shifting momentum in his own favour. Needs to be careful not to get himself disqualified. I feel like that's a very Jay Steins thing to do. I've pointed out good fight IQ here amongst some of the wrestlers we've seen here tonight. There is none of that with Jay Steins. I wouldn't really consider him to be, perhaps the most intelligent on our roster, but Big Rab. Currently in a position he didn't expect to be in, though, to be fair. I mean, Jay Steins has taken Rab off his feet. He's neutralized him for the time being. And now he's going to lift him up. And if he gets this, Well, to be fair, he's going after the leg. He's chosen a target. He's exploiting it to the best of his ability. I mean, this isn't bad work from Jay Steins, to his credit. Time will tell if it'll be enough to put Big Rab away and snap his losing streak. But yeah, you look at how red his chest is and his back is after one or two strikes, though, and it's really, if Big Rab gets any attack in whatsoever, I don't really favour Steins, it has to be said. And even from the ground, even from the bottom, you see Big Rab with a kick to the back of Jay Steins, and Jay just squealing in pain. You know, people in the crowd are saying that he looks like a transition year student. I wouldn't say that. I mean, Jay Steins, he has been to Compton. He has fought on the streets. Little video evidence of this exists, but it is true. Oh, but this is what I'm talking about. Big Rab with a belly-to-belly in the corner. And Jay Steins looks like he's out of it. And to be fair, he's not out of it. You know, he has been pinned. It's not over. But, you know, at the same time, you look at him and the physical advantage is quite strong. I can barely hear myself over everybody chanting for Big Rab. Big Rab with these forearms. Jay Steins doing the smart thing, ducking underneath and taking out the legs from underneath Big Rab. I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out, you know, in a strike-for-strike battle, you know, forearms, punches, when you're just standing there trading back and forth, that's not going to be a fight that you win against Big Rab. And that's not even a slight on Jay Steins. You could say that about most fighters in this promotion. I mean, you look at Big Rab. He just took his head. I'm surprised that's not it. I'm really surprised that's not it. He took Steins' head completely off. If he didn't kick out at two, I'd be expecting Foxy to check for a pulse. Rab off the middle turnbuckle. Jay Steins again doing the smart thing. Very easy to headhunt in this sport. You know, if you see the head open, a lot of people go for those punches, for those kicks to the head. Oh, and I thought Jay Steins was actually going to get up there. But Steins doing the smart thing, and he's, you know, now he's going for the head, but he's taking his time. He's implemented a strategy where he started at the leg and he's chopped down Big Rab like a tree. And it's, that's the sort of stuff, you know, you can wave your gun signs, you can say gangland this and gangland that, but I mean, that's wrestling ability, that's fight IQ on display there from Jay Steins, and that's what wins you matches. You know, it's very impressive to see, despite the physical advantage that Big Rab has, to see Steins, I mean, this is what I'm talking about, but you know, that's what makes it more impressive. You see one chop from Big Rab is enough to take out Jay Steins, and look at that, he couldn't even pick him up. That's, Big Rab catches him. Oh, and Big Rab with the lumbar check and a lariat. But it's interesting, he's limping, he's struggling to pull this off. He goes for the package pile driver, he just about gets it. Just about gets exactly what he needs, and that's it. Congratulations to Big Rab, yet another win for the man himself, but I mean, I don't know, like, I'm impressed by Jay Steins, to be honest. I'm impressed by his ability to very nearly take Big Rab out by targeting his leg. However, it has to be said, ultimately, Big Rab, despite the pain that he felt in his leg and the struggles he felt, you know, to sort of, you see him now getting lifted away by one of our paramedics. But he fought on. He got the win, got the result. And he impressed along the way in his own right. I think a lot of people are going to be struggling with Big Rab. With time to come, but Jay Steins, he's not going to be happy with that. Jay Steins, he wants to... Oh, what's this? Jay Steins wanted a fight. Jay Steins making a call out. That's never gone well for him in the past, but... Oh! Oh! No way! No way! Yes! Dom Tuck, the king, has returned! Fucking yes! I've said it in the past, call-outs have never gone well for Jay Steins. They have never worked out. And I've never seen it work out any worse than this. Jay Steins looked like he's seen a ghost. The man that he betrayed, the man that he left on the shelf for months, the man who he very nearly made leave wrestling forever. But it appears that Dom Tuck is back in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling. And Dom Tuck raining down strikes. Jay Steins escaping, not very gangland of him, but can you blame him? Dom Tuck is back in Fight Factory Pro Wrestling. This is... Man, I have sat here and commentated Eric Redbeard matches. I have seen some incredible things in Fight Factory, but this is up there for me, man. This is the jacket and everything. Oh, man. Man like DeReese and Leon Slater, North Wrestling Tag Team Champions, 1PW Tag Team Champions. I'll let the entrance speak for itself. This is a serious, serious tag team. One of the best in Europe right now. But so too are the champions. There's a reason this match is on last. There's a reason this is the main event. And the Savers of Destiny are no strangers to the main event. They've been there before plenty of times. The last time the tag team titles were on the line in the main event, we saw a war. We saw how deep the Savers of Destiny are willing to dig to hold on to those titles. And that was their first title run. Ever since they suffered that shock defeat to JB and Party Boy. I mean, it's not even the same tag team. It's the same with Destiny, but with a whole new layer of danger and ruthlessness. Owen Richards, the real deal Andy Steele. If you've watched Fight Factory Pro Wrestling before, I mean, they don't need any introduction. They hold those belts for a reason. I said that Boisterous Behavior are arguably the best tag team in Europe. The same argument could very easily be made about the Savers of Destiny. Anywhere they have gone, they have dominated. Not just one, dominated. So I am... This is unpredictable for me. I genuinely cannot call this one. That can't be the introductions. Time to answer the question of who wins. I mean, that's what's been asked really from the moment this match was announced. You know, it's not really a question many have an answer for. You know, going into a match, usually a match as big as this, everyone has their opinions, everybody has their predictions, but it really is a tough one to predict. You know, we're talking about two teams of very equal ability. What's interesting here is that, you know, a man like Luis, you heard Colm list out his accomplishments and his accolades up there right now. We look at the best wrestlers in Europe as individuals. And man like Therese, he is up there. I mean, he'd be top 10, top 5 possibly, you know, getting to the top. That's as a singles competitor. And he didn't even come here alone. You know, this is, he's come here with Leon Slater, who, I mean, Leon Slater's almost scared. I mean, and to be as talented as he is at his age, he's only a teenager, you know what I mean? It's insane, really, but that's just the level that they operate at. However, that's not a level that's unusual to the Sabres and Destiny. I mean, the last time the Sabres and Destiny took on a huge international tag team, it was Lycos Jim in right here in the Fight Factory about a year ago. And this is, again, we're talking the Sabres from a year ago. You look at how much bigger they've gotten in the last year. But even a year ago, they took care of business that way. And that was the last time where involving international acts, where a huge question was asked of the Sabres, could they get it done on the biggest stage against the biggest acts? And a year ago, they said that they showed that they could. So, you know, you definitely can't rule the Sabres out with this one. I mean, what's very interesting to me is the mentality of the Sabres and the fact that right now, you know, the Sabres of Destiny, lose, you know, a lot of wrestlers will come into a match and they'll be thinking, you know, I need to do this to win, or I can't lose, or, you know, winning and losing. Losing isn't even on the mind of the Sabres. Losing isn't even an option, almost. It's you know, they're coming here, they're taking care of business, and that is the end of that. Very interesting to see how Owen Richards matches up with Therese physically. You know, Owen Richards, it's often, you know, in tag teams, each member of a tag team, their singles ability is often overlooked. In Owen Richards' case, I feel as though his physicality and his strength is often his most overlooked asset. And you see how he uses it against a man like Therese here. It's very impressive, you know, and this is against somebody who, a man like Therese is a tank, you know, and you're seeing that on full display here. It just goes to show, again, anyone can win this here. Owen Richards kicks out a two, and you can see Andy Steele, even at this early stage, he was ready to jump in and break up the pin when required. I mean, the same with Destiny, what they have shown since they first showed up here at Fight Factory Pro Wrestling, their ability to work together as a team, their chemistry, their cohesion, you know, how they operate as one, it is so, so impressive. But, you know, the same can obviously be said about the recent Slater, you know, that's what the best tag teams do, but that's why the Sabres are on that level. Andy Steele and Leon Slater, I mean, that in itself would be a banger of a singles match, but it's going to be interesting to see how these two, you know, who gets the upper hand between these two, but of course, there is the element of teamwork thrown in there, there is the element of a partner on either side, but Andy Steele showing off his agility. Leon Slater not too impressed by the theatrics of Andy Steele. Before Andy Steele was even finished his sentence, Leon Slater, I mean, he doesn't just take care of business, he makes it a spectacle. You know, Leon Slater is just so much fun to watch. I mean, he was thrown out of the ring there by Andy Steele, but he even makes it look like he meant it. You know, even makes it look like completely unfazed. But Andy Steele coming from behind, grabbing the hair of Slater. Slater swiping Andy Steele off his feet, and then over the top. He comes flying in. One thing you'll notice about Leon Slater, a valuable trait of his, is the fact that he's not afraid to take risks, and he's not afraid to put his body on the line as well. That's something that you'll see from Leon Slater. But to be fair, the same can also be said about Andy Steele. I mean, we've seen him sacrifice everything, you know, to keep the titles in the hands of the Saviors, as has Owen Richards. I suppose it's what all the best tag team partners do for each other. But it's very interesting to see Leon Slater make his debut here in Fight Factory. Because it really is, there's no pressure. You know, we see a lot of debuts here in Fight Factory. A lot of wrestlers that come in here from the likes of Belgium and, you know, all across Europe, and you know, even our own lads coming up through Project Next Gen, and there's a lot of nerves. You know, even with the Bradley brothers, for example, they might not have shown it, but they would have been a bit nervous coming in here and taking on the Saviors of Destiny, you know, in their first match. But Leon Slater and a man like Therese, they come in and there is no nerves. There is just, they're not just that they're not nervous, they're incredibly confident. They ooze confidence. And the flair that they have when they really put the beat on their opponents is, you know, it's very, very unique. They have their own kind of signature, their own style. I mean, that is partly why they are arguably the best tag team in Europe right now. It's nobody can do what they can do, and that is the key to a good tag team. Kicking out with two. It's interesting when you see the recent Slater, when you see them, you know, dancing around and, you know, again, making a spectacle, making a show of their work. A lot of people think that's them underestimating their opponent. I don't really believe that to be the case. I believe that is them finding their momentum. And, you know, in this case, Andy Steele managing to shift momentum into his own favor with those kicks, which are, of course, an Andy Steele signature. But the quickness of Therese to be able to land on his feet and land kicks of his own is just, it's so impressive. You know, like, this is a team that, you know, they're wanted all over Europe for a reason. Not only an incredibly fun team to watch, but, you know, you'll get teams who are fun to watch. You know, you get teams that are fun to watch, but perhaps not the most effective. This is not the case with these two. I mean, this is a team that's fun to watch, but incredibly efficient in their output, incredibly effective with their striking, with their movement, with their cohesion, with everything. They tick all the right boxes. Andy Steele, despite taking a bit of a beating thus far off Slater and Therese, still looks pretty fresh. He's in great shape. I mean, the cardio of Andy Steele, you know, and Owen Richards, I mean, team that we've seen, and this is what I'm talking about. This is what I'm talking about. A partner that's willing to sacrifice everything for his partner. You know, a tag team that's willing to sacrifice everything for the win. That's what you need to be in order to be the Irish tag team champions. And the Saviors are going to be careful. They don't want to get disqualified. I mean, it's quite an emotional affair, you know, as well. When you're on a stage this big, in a match this big. You know, and also you take into account that this is a team, you know, Therese especially, the sort of wrestler that knows how to get under his opponent's skin and into their head. You know, if Owen Richards and Andy Steele aren't careful and they allow their opponents to get into their head, I mean, that's when things get, you know, they can get a bit sloppy, because an emotional fighter is a sloppy fighter. They make mistakes, they overextend themselves, but, you know, I think the same with Destiny will have that under control. I mean, this is something that they do as well to their opponents. You know, the taunting, the can you feel it, you know. It's not new to them, but it's interesting to see how they adapt to Slater and Therese. Because really, I mean, we've seen the Saviors, you know, on the biggest stage from Bachelor and Fight Factory. We've seen them pass every test with flying colours. But we've never seen them fight a team that, that really operates in the same level as Slayer and Dries, or operates in the same way stylistically, I should say. And I think it's going to be interesting to see how they adapt to Dries and Slayer, because they're quite different tag teams. You know, I think the Saviors are, well, you know, there's similarities but there's differences. I think Owen Richards is almost the Saviors equivalent of Dries in the sense that he's more physically imposing. He'll be physically stronger. And then you have Andy Steele, who'd be almost like Leon Slater's equivalent in the sense that he's the more agile of the two. And he's coming out with the kicks and the, you know, flying and speed and stuff. But at the same time, despite this, the two teams just have very different ways of operating. And it's interesting to see who will come out on top by the end of this. Currently, both teams are still very much in this. Of course, there's a lot on the line. Both teams have had to pace themselves. You know, you can't exert too much energy early on, or you'll gas yourself out. And your opponent, of course, will take full advantage of that. The Sabres are very good at pacing themselves, very good at strategizing, very good at slowing things down when they need to without weakening themselves. I haven't watched enough of the recent Slater outside of certain promotions to see, you know, are they as good at pacing themselves? But, you know, you have to imagine they would be, otherwise they wouldn't be, you know, double champs. Possibly triple champs come the end of tonight. We'll wait and see. But, oh, Richards clinging on to Slater's foot for dear life to stop that from happening. If Leon Slater makes the tag, you have to wonder what's going to happen, and wonder no more, because Leon Slater doesn't make the tag, because Andy Steele manages to cling on to Dries and stop any potential, any progressive movement from that team to take place just for a little bit. Dries is in there, he's throwing all his uppercuts, and Owen Richards looks rocked, but Andy Steele definitely did delay the process, and now he's been tagged in himself. If Dries turns around, it's over. It is. Oh! That was clean. That was right where he wanted it to be. That was right on the chin. And Owen Richards looked to be in trouble there for a minute, but Andy Steele has neutralized things with that spinning back kick to the head, and now a suplex. Dries kicks out at two, but I have to say, he doesn't look as confident or as flashy as he did a couple of minutes ago. That kick, he would still be feeling the effects of that. And Richards tags himself in. And now the Saviors have men like Dries over on their side of the ring. And after all the effort of Leon Slater to tag in Dries, it looks like the effort was almost in vain. The mentality of Leon Slater, at his age especially, but this is what happens when you train around greats that are currently on the scene. You know, you develop quickly. But Leon Slater getting the fans behind man like Dries and, you know, willing him on. I mean, that's smart. That is smart. That's fight IQ. That's getting the fans, you know, almost using them as a weapon against the Sabres. It's very, very smart. And now Dries makes the tag. In comes Slater with a clothesline and a second and a third. Andy Steele counters it. He counters it. I was going to say Andy Steele off his feet, but no, Andy Steele. I have to say, I've noticed Andy Steele has been the more switched on of the two in this fight. Andy Steele has really been on the ball for the Sabres when he has needed to be thus far, and I feel like that's something that's really going to stand to them as this fight progresses, as we get into the championship rounds, as they would say in MMA, you know, when the fight ticks on and we really start to see who's made of what. The work that Andy Steele has been putting in up to this point, that's what's really going to count come the end. And Andy Steele again running in up off his partner onto the back. I I have to say, this is one of the strongest performances I've seen from Andy Steele. I mean, possibly ever. He's looked really good. And Owen Richards as well. He's looking comfortable in there now. You know, this is what I mean. The best tag teams, the partners, you know, work off each other. You know, one partner has an excellent performance and this the other. And now Owen Richards. He's doing the smart thing. This is really good from Owen Richards. Keeping Therese in the corner. And stopping any progression, any momentum from reaching away of boisterous behavior. Steele just looks like he's having fun in there. You know, this is what I was saying about Savers of Destiny. You know, ever since they got their belts back, it's a new Savers. It's, you know, they're just on a mission now. They're on a mission to win every single fight for the rest of their careers. Honestly, it really is. It feels like they're on a train now that's just not going to be derailed. Even against a team as good as Slater and Therese. I say, as Slater lands on his feet, but again, he goes to make the tag and it's cut off by Owen Richards. Owen Richards holding onto the foot, ducking underneath, but he doesn't see. Well, I was going to say he doesn't see the kick from Slater, the second kick. Well, all he's seeing right now are the lights in the ceiling after Leon Slater took care of him. But can Slater take advantage of this, capitalize on it, and tag in Therese? Now, this is going to be game changing. Whoever makes the first tag here really could be looking. Oh well, I was going to say the Saviors made the tag first, but ultimately it made no difference. And a missile dropkick off the top from Therese. Owen Richards runs in. I mean, the agility of Therese is crazy. Yeah, it really is. I mean, Andy Steele trying to slow him down. But Therese, I mean, as they say, Therese is on fire. There really is no slowing down man like Therese when he gets going. One of the best singles wrestlers in Europe right now, but also one of the best tag team wrestlers in Europe right now. Man like Therese is doing it all. Shows the importance of trying to prevent a tag, especially when the partner who's meant to be tagged in has been waiting for so long. They come in, they're full of energy, and it's almost like, you know, a Royal Rumble, somebody, a new opponent entering the fight. It's, you know, Therese really does look unstoppable right now. Andy Steele, that's really good work from Andy Steele. Just when it looks like he was getting battered, just when it looks like he had very little left to give in attack, running Therese into his own corner. I mean, if nothing else, wait a minute, this could be, I was going to say, potentially going for a call to action there. I mean, that's the move that's put everyone away in Saviors matches in the past. Course, Saviour is unable to hit that move right now, and Slater gets tagged in, and Slater goes up to Owen Richards. Owen Richards ducks underneath. Oh, Leon Slater. So I would usually say going strike for strike with Owen Richards is a bad idea, but Slater fancies himself, and using his speed, he gets the better of Owen Richards. Owen Richards could be in trouble here. Kicks out at 2.5. something here. Leon Slater going to the top turnbuckle. This is now where Owen Richards wants to be. Dangerous, dangerous territory. Slater off the top. He's not able to hit what he was going for. That's why they call it high risk. And you know, usually you reward something with, you know, with high risk comes high reward, but I mean, it looks to me like that's completely changed things. The saviors could end up, no, off the top. I've spoken way too soon there. Off the top, Leon Slater breaking up the pin. He looks to still be in quite a bit of pain, but he's fighting through that because, I mean, it's one thing winning tag team championships, it's another to win two tag team championships. But these two men, they are going for their third tag team championships in the form of those Irish tag team titles.
Come on.
Also worth remembering that whoever does win this fight will be taking on LJ Cleary and Fabio in episode 29. They're not going to be giving themselves, they're not going to be doing themselves too much favours. But the scraps start happening now. I mean, this is, I doubt these men are going to be fully recovered in a month, but we'll see. Just incredible from the recent Slater to have turned things around, and now they've hit what they were going for. And this, oh, and out comes, out comes Anita Vaughn. It just makes you sick. It makes you sick. You know, there's no need. I mean, she's not even on the card tonight. There really is no reason for Anita Vaughn to be in the building. I understand managers. I understand the role that they play. I mean, but this is. Oh, and out to the outside. Dereese wiping out everyone. He wiped out Anita Vaughn. Also wiped out Foxy. Andy Steele gets caught in midair, and now we've no ref to count. Foxy's been taken out. And could this be yet another case of the same as a destiny winning because of Anita Vaughn interference, getting bailed out by their third member, who, to her credit, and I really don't want to give her credit because it's looking to be credited in this situation, but she is as important as the other two. You know, that is a fact. Ask anyone who watches the Saviors, you know, it, sometimes, I mean, a lot of the time they do get into the ground, but a lot of the time they do require that interference and help from Anita Vaughn in big events like this. And now we see a double low blow. Slater's been thrown out. Dereese is being lifted up for a call to action. They hit it. Foxy's recovered just about. And Dereese kicks out at two. Brilliant. Brilliant. You know, look, I'm going to be professional. I'm not going to pick a side here or who to root for, who to boo for, none of that, right? But regardless of who you're a fan of and who you hate, who you love, who you hate, it's never nice to see matches of this caliber end in such a way. And I'm glad that Dereese, at the very least, and Slater have another chance to rescue this match. They're going for a second call to action, but Slater is in up on the corner. Over the two men! Over the two men! A cross body, but Owen Richards with the spear. Completely cutting off any momentum for Leon Slater. And Dereese is on his feet, and a cutter! this is incredible. Leon Slater tagged in. I mean, this is why the recent Slater are one of the best tag teams in Europe, arguably the best tag team in Europe, and they could be on their way to winning their third tag team championships. First from Slater, next from Darice. A 450. And that's it! Well, Foxy. Well, Foxy is he's had a disagreement there. I'm a bit unsure as to what Foxy has waved off. It's hard to see from where I'm standing. I believe he potentially wasn't a legal man. And Andy Steele is back in. I don't think Foxy saw the tag. Well, this is a controversial one. Anita Vaughn's not going to care. The Sabres aren't going to care. But this is a controversial one. From my perspective, it really did look as though the recent Slater, it looked like they had it won. It really did. And I think when people walk out of the building tonight, they're going to be saying that the real winners of this match, not the same as in the care, but the recent Slater, this doesn't feel right. But it also means we're getting the Saviors versus LJ and Fabio on our next show. That's going to be incredible. That's a match we've seen before, and I tore the roof off this place. And we never got a satisfactory conclusion because, of course, it ended due to interference from Justin Daniels at that time. And now we get to see it all over again, which is exciting, but you have to look at Leon Slater, a man like Darice, and from their perspective, they pinned the champions. They just didn't win the belts. Time we see these teams square off here at Fight Factory. I agree with the fans. I would love to see this team return. Just incredible to watch. But for now, it's time for celebration for the Saviors. Oh, and here comes, speaking of the devil, LJ Cleary and Fabio. Be a banger. Look forward to seeing you all then. Thanks for joining us, and we will see you at the Fight Factory for episode 29.